Good morning. I'm glad to see you. The singing experience is a bit different. Of course, we lose the volume that we're used to, used to a full house, but also used to the clearer projection. So it actually forces me to pay attention more to my singing to the Lord. I don't know if Kathy was even able to hear me. I was singing as loud as I could, and I didn't know whether that was getting to you or, actually Shirley should have heard it first. But my point is that if you notice that it's very, very difficult for you to sing to your neighbor, which is a part of what we're supposed to do. Rich read some of that text. So I hope you remember these things. There's often I would like to stop and say, do you remember what we're doing? Well, part of what we're doing in those minutes, especially with those two songs, is we're singing as much to each other as we are to the Lord. I hope you know that. And you can't feel badly about the quality of your tone or your whatever. That can't be the issue. Otherwise, that takes the worship out of the equation. So more than likely, a congregation like this, even though we sing really, really well normally, it would help us at times to remember what we're doing. Those songs go up to the Lord for sure, but they are also designed to teach each other, and that's why it's so important for us to learn theology and to sing accordingly. So I always enjoy that. It's part of really one of the reasons why I love coming here is the opportunity to sing with you. And this is all unfortunate, but we've gone through this a lot, right? So I'm just delighted you're here, and I know it's warm. So we're doing our best to have some air on, but also some ventilation. So if you are overcome by the heat, just nap quietly. Don't snore. Snoring disrupts worship totally. The nodding off is a normal Sunday occurrence. I will not name names, but I see you every Sunday, okay? And I'm glad to see you now. I hope you know that. And glad to have some teaching time together. So let's go to prayer, then we'll... It's our custom to read the scriptures aloud together. We can remain seated for that, but let's pray, shall we? Father, thank you for those minutes. I know that you're happy to hear us, especially those of us who are able to sing those songs with our understanding and truly heartfelt appreciation for who you are, what you've done in Christ, what you're doing through Christ and your Spirit, and what you are going to do when Christ returns. That is our ultimate hope, but we're here today. So we are continuing to face and to feel the effects of a badly broken world. We know that the curse is active. We're feeling it. And we want desperately to be able to receive guidance for worship in the meantime while we wait for your return. I'm just delighted to see these dear ones again. Thank you for encouraging them to get here despite all of this. And I pray, as has been prayed, that these minutes that we're together are valuable for the sake of your reputation in the church and in the world. Several of us are going to go out from here and we'll rub shoulders with folks who do not know their Creator, and we have an opportunity to tell them how they can. And so we look forward to those times. Give us extra boldness. I was glad, Lord, for these the handful of parishioners that reminded me not that long ago that they're even more eager to tell others about the Lord Jesus Christ because of this time. So may their tribe increase. We're just glad for that, Lord. And so thank you so much for this time together. You know we always need you, though, Lord. I need you. I'm always over my head in these things. And in this psalm, it's no different. Guard my mind and my mouth during the teaching time so that this presentation is clear and that you can use it for your glory. I know that the Holy Spirit will ultimately be our teacher. And I pray for these dear ones, too, in their interactions so that while they hear and read, that they will respond as an act of worship to you. That's what we want to do together. Thank you for hearing this prayer. In Christ's name I pray. Amen. All right, folks, let's read the scriptures together. You'll see it should be Psalm 34. So we'll read 1 through 8. We'll start with the title, which is lengthier than normal, especially the last couple of them. We'll start with the title. We'll read down to verse 8. Then you'll notice verses 11 to 14. All right, so do your best and let's read this aloud together, shall we? Of David, when he changed his behavior before Abimelech so that he drove him out and he went away. I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise shall continually be in my mouth. My soul makes its boast in the Lord. Let the humble hear and be glad. Oh, magnify the Lord with me, and let us exalt his name together. I sought the Lord, and he answered me and delivered me from all my fears. Those who look to him are radiant, and their faces shall never be ashamed. This poor man cried, and the Lord heard him and saved him out of all his troubles. The angel of the Lord encamps around those who fear him and delivers them. Oh, taste and see that the Lord is good. Blessed is the man who takes refuge in him. Come, O children, listen to me. I will teach you the fear of the Lord. What man is there who desires life and loves many days, that he may see good? Keep your tongue from evil and your lips from speaking deceit. Turn away from evil and do good. Seek peace and pursue it. Now, this is carefully crafted poetry. It's God's word in the form of carefully crafted poetry. And it's the second time for us that we've encountered something like this. So if you've ever wondered, reading the Psalms, like Psalm 34, why does it read the way it does? It doesn't read straight through. Well, that's the reason for that is because it's an acrostic or an alphabetic psalm. If you're listening, listen while you're reading each verse, beginning at verse 1, the start of every verse is working its way through the Hebrew alphabet, with two exceptions. The sixth letter, Vav, is missing because, except for our conjunction and, it's just hard to find a Hebrew word that starts with that letter, which is odd. I was saying to Michelle, even under inspiration, there was a glitch. This is the second time, by the way. You'll see it, John, in, I think, Psalm 25 and 34, our psalm. They both share the same glitch. The letters are going in successive order, and then all of a sudden, there's a break. The other exception is at the very end, like Psalm 25 again. At the very end of the psalm, the last verse functions as a summary and it brings the psalm to a delightful end, but it breaks the acrostic. So when you're reading Psalm 34, you are receiving instruction for how to worship, but it is very stylized, which is going to explain some of the oddities as you move from verse to verse. You're trying to figure out, well, why this, why this? Well, because the author is using a thesaurus, trying to find just the right word in the Hebrew language to fit the start. So it's well crafted, but that would bore most of you to tears, correct? Be honest, right? The only reason why I like to tell you about it, he's nodding his head ferociously. The reason why I want to tell you stuff like that is so that what you're looking at is a masterpiece, and I don't know if you appreciate, it's not just the content of the Psalter. Sometimes it's the construction, the style of it. God has put incredible amount of his wisdom into the writing of such things, and it's an amazing piece of poetry or song, whatever you want to call it. But if you're more interested in this for this morning, how about this? First of all, this is one of these places where you're going to be asked to be in constant praise in the midst of a badly broken world, which is, and I'll ask you about this a little later. So some of the unique contributions of this psalm, and these are the places we're going to focus on, is this call to constant praise and thanksgiving to God. The second thing is, you're very familiar, if you look at your reading, if you haven't ditched that already, if you look at the reading, you'll notice the use of the sense of taste in that very familiar verse. How many of you are familiar with the verse 8? Oh, taste and see that the Lord is good. We're familiar with that. And so you'll notice that the use of the senses and the use of body parts is throughout this psalm. I'm especially interested in what's happening at verse 8 with the sense of taste. We'll have some fun with that in a little bit later. And then finally, when you look at verse 11, at verse 11 and following, it's almost like you have been, you've left Psalms and you've entered Proverbs, the very next book of the Bible. And so what we're dealing with here is a call to learn. And so these three things are very, very, I think, unique enough in Psalm 34 for us to spend some time on. And then, You know, as always, I try to give you a little path to follow and if you're interested. So what I want to do is I want to look first at our call to constant praise, which I talked to you about. The second section of the Psalter deals with why we offer that praise continually. And that contains the famous verse 8. And then finally, it is only for those of us who are willing to learn. And so we take the place as learners again. We come to church and say, Lord, we want to follow you. Be our master, teacher, be our instructor as we look at this. So that's the path I want to take. I'm going to my own Psalm 34. I want to dig into this because we got a lot to cover. And let me tell you my rationale. So we're 30-something Psalms into this, right? So in order to keep a series like this moving, my choices are, we'll spend time as we move forward on the unique contributions of the Psalms, knowing that we've covered a lot of this before. Like there's tons of calls to worship in the Psalms. And so we'll be looking at those if they contribute some new data for us. So we will not cover everything in depth. You know, if you have a question about some details, please get with me after or later on. I'll be glad to do that. But this first part is interesting. So take a look at the title. Now, we've hardly done anything with the titles, so a lot of these English translations are saying this was the time when David changed his behavior, but that's not quite enough. He does, but David in this particular narrative where we're going back into the Old Testament, this psalm is connected to the time when David pretended to lose his senses, or he pretended to be a madman in order to save himself. His life was in danger. It was what I found interesting, and I want you to see this, that the writer of Psalms links Psalm 34 to this event. And frankly, I first read this and said, David took matters into his own hand. He didn't trust the Lord for him at all. He put into place this plan. I'm going to make myself look like I've lost my senses, I've lost my mind, I've lost my understanding, and I want you to remember that when you get to verse 8. Now, I'm prepping you for this, so you have to help me, and I'm not going to ask Bill Osborne to remind me when I get there, because that was last week, and that was a huge failure, so let's not go there, right? Let's just say, just relax, right? When you get to verse 8, remember this. At the very title of Psalm 34, David says, I want to tell you about a time when I decided that in order to save my own skin, I would pretend that I've lost my mind. But he says, I'm going to give all the credit for the plan to God, which I found very, very fascinating. So if you were like me, when I read this for the first time, I think, where was his faith? And then after I came to my own senses, pun intended, I thought, I know where his faith was. He came up with a good plan, and he attributed that plan to the wisdom of God. So I hope some of you can see faith in a new way. So before we go much further, just watch Psalm 34 highlighting the deliverance of God. But it was at a time when David really, literally used his head on this one. And he said, I think I've got a way out of this pickle that I'm in. And so it's a fascinating look at a man of God's faith, trusting God to use a plan that he came up with. And so I just wanted you to see that. And the change in his behavior is fine. It's just that he looked as if he lost his mind. He did not have his senses, remember verse 8, okay? But let's get into this constant call first. This constant call to bless the Lord or to praise. And I think the notes are saying constant praise because you'll see that the second of three actions. So point number one, look at verse 1. Three actions that we are called to do continually. And so you want to bless the Lord continually, you want to praise the Lord continually, and you want to boast in the Lord continually. Those three things. You want to do that all the time. Tim, can we show that slide, please? Just see I forget what it looked like. So yeah, and it fits the song that we sang. So you'll notice three actions that you're being asked to do. So if you look at this, I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise shall continually be in my mouth. My soul makes its boast in the Lord. Stop there. And let me ask you, if I said to you, I want you, as an act of worship, to speak well of God. And that's going to be the summary definition for all three. You'll notice bless, praise, and boast. I want you to speak well of God all the time. What would be your pushback, class? Anybody that can yell it out through this the barrier? Or anybody without the barrier? What would be your pushback if I said, you should be doing this all the time? The first, MJ says from the front, the first thing is it's not easy. What else? Well, yeah, certainly people on the other end don't want to hear it, that's for sure. You could face some opposition. What else? If I say do it all the time, why is it so difficult to praise God all the time? You don't feel like it at all. And the fact is, if that was Craig, I think it was Craig's voice. Okay, there you are. If you don't feel like it, more than likely, you've got some crushing circumstances happening. Or if you're not crushed, you're pretty much crinkled a little bit. I mean, you're feeling the weight of some of this. And so this is what makes this very, very difficult. And the psalmist says, I want you to follow my example. I will, when you see any of the I wills in the Psalter, all you're seeing is you're seeing the intention of a man of God who's supposed to lead worship. And so his intention is, I tell you what I'm going to do. I will do these three things all the time. So that means there, no matter, and I guess we can do this for the sake of time. Listen, it doesn't matter what the circumstances are. It doesn't really matter how you're feeling the effects of being under the curse in a badly broken world. The bottom line is there's never a time when it's not appropriate to put into a conversation the goodness of God. There's never a time when that's not appropriate. That's what the psalmist is saying. Now the reason why the Psalms are so important to us is because they are real about the pain. It's not just praise all the time without pain. It's praise all the time in the context of pain. David knows this full well. And so what makes the Psalms speak to us so often and so well is because they're real about this. So there's never a time when you can't insert in a conversation something like this. I want to let you know, God is really a good God. I was thinking about all of the potential things you could brag about. You could. So take yourself out of being super spiritual just for a moment and just think about the things you could brag about, that you could. Do you have your list started? Okay. How many do you have? Like some of you. Seth, how many do you have? Like 110 or something at least. Or who else can I pick on? You got your list, things that you could brag about. One of the reasons why David talks like this and he writes a song like this is he says, you know, all of those things that you could legitimately boast in about, how did you get them? That's all. What's the source of all of that? Joe, imagine all of the things that you could potentially really boast about and say, you know, I've been able to accomplish this, 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 and this. And you could easily follow that up in a conversation and say to a person, you know, God has been really, really good to me throughout my lifetime. Could you do that? Class, could you do that? Now, I was saying to myself earlier this week, you know, there's no way for me to do that. And I can't put him in conversation if he's not in my mind, if he's not on my mind first. That I was thinking that for me had to be the most intentional movement in a psalm like this. For me personally, I thought that what I need to do is I need to keep him on my mind more. If I'm going to put him in conversation, he has to be first in my mind. I have to think about his goodness over and over again. As a matter of fact, if I continually reflect on the fact that he's been good to me and he is good to me, it will be, of course, much easier for me to say in a conversation, let me take 10 seconds and let me speak well of God. In the midst of the conversation, God has been really, really good to me. Can you do that? Please say yes, you're in church. At least say it now. And then when you go, then you're on your own. I mean, it's on you. But at least for now, say, I can do that. I can, in a conversation with everyone, I can remind everyone I talk to, God has been really good to me. I have a lot to be thankful for. A lot. Now you know that. I know you do. What's great about the opening is these three actions are, we're instructed to follow his example of doing them all the time. And that's why this point one is just our call to constant praise. You'll notice at the end of verse two, if you were wondering, is he talking about just the times when things are going well? No, you know that. Look at the end of verse two, because the folks that are supposed to listen to him. So let's pretend David is up here and he's leading you for the first time in singing this song. You've never heard the song. It's a new song, like, I don't know if it was last week or the week before, something about a new song. So David, King David, the song leader, the worship leader, leading the congregation in this new song. And for the very first time, he's saying to you, look at the kind of person that's supposed to hear this and be glad. Let the humble hear and be glad. Now, what's important about that is he says this to an entire congregation. So he's not talking about an entire congregation that's impoverished. He's talking about an entire congregation that he knows, due to the circumstances of living in this badly broken world, everyone in the house is feeling the effects of some of the brokenness. That's what he's saying. And so when he says, let the humble hear and be glad, he's talking about the folks who have been oppressed by the circumstances. Some of my friends from afar who help me with these types of studies, they would use the word lowly. And the reason why they'll use a word like that is because it's a good reflection of this term. But what it says is it talks about a person who literally is feeling the weight, the pressure of being in a badly broken world. And they are feeling the oppressive effects of it all. We're the ones that are supposed to hear. And then what's supposed to be your response? So you try this, okay? Try this before, I don't know if you, no, you'll have to do it when you get outside, because I think when this is over, am I correct? When this is over, ushers will help people go. Just like always, Jonathan looks at me and rolls his eyes. It's like, how many times do I have to tell you this? You idiot. Right? Did I capture your eye roll? When you get outside and you're set free outside, when you get outside, if you can find shade, try this and watch what happens to a person's face. If you, of course, they might remember, they might not. Sneak into your conversation with someone outside. God has been very, very good to me. And watch the expression on that other face. Watch what happens to their face. Now, don't do it because I just prepped you for it. Do it because it's a real sincere. Watch what happens to a person, especially in the congregation. And then Linda's comment was interesting down here off to my right. What if you find yourself in a conversation with someone who does not know the Lord? And you put in the conversation something, you speak well of him. What might the expression on the face be? I don't know if it would be the smile. It might be, what are you, weird? Or I don't know. But I can just imagine if you say it and it sinks in, I can just imagine the wheels start to turn. I wonder what he or she meant by that. You never know, right? I'm just saying this is a delightful line B of verse 2. All of us described as the humble. So when the Jerusalem, Jewish Study Bible sort of helps with this type of section. The humble are every single parishioner that says, I know that I'm living every day totally dependent on the goodness of God, period. And I say yes to that. I live every day in total dependence on the goodness of God, not on my abilities, but on the goodness of God. And that's a nice place for a worshiper to be. That's at the end of two. When you get to three, you've seen this before, so don't get caught up in both of these terms, verse 3, magnify and exalt. You'll notice the enlarging. You know what magnification is, right? And then exalting is a little difficult. Now, we know it because we're church people, but you're talking about just making the Lord look greater and greater and greater and greater and larger and larger. Larger than life is a term that we're aware of. And verse 3 says, we're supposed to do this together. It's one of the greatest things for Calvary Bible Church to do. I think it happens best in song, by the way. I do. But we've been together for a long time, and I know that in our interaction, there are moments when we do this during the teaching as well. We're all together. We read this text and say, we do serve a great God. And I know you know that. We live for a great God. That's all a part of this opening, verses 1 to 3. Let's look at the reasons in point 2, the good reasons for doing this, all right? All right, I want you to take a look at verse 4. Let me first say, before you get to yourself in this, let me say to you that in verse 4, when you read, from all my fears, I sought the Lord and he answered me and delivered me from all my fears. This is the first of many reasons why. We sang about it earlier. We'll look at it now. It's the first of many reasons why we are constantly praising the Lord like this. Well, because how many of you have experienced verse 4 repeatedly in your life? Well, take a look at the end of verse 4, and delivered me from all my fears. You want to read that a little stronger than that. You want to read that from all of your terrors. Fear softens this just a bit. But we're talking about something that is normally describing the object of your dread and terror. So that's the strength of this in verse 4. And I just want to ask you again, if you didn't get it the first time, look at verse 4 and tell me how many of you have experienced this. In your lifetime, in your time with the Lord, how many of you have experienced this? You prayed, he heard, and he answered. Class? All right, second, was this once and done? Was that a once and done? I hope not. Some of you seasoned saints with the Lord, hopefully you would be able to talk to someone that's younger in the Lord and say, I can't number. Maybe, I don't know, maybe that's why Matt Redman did this, 10,000 reasons. I can't number the amount of times when this happened to me in my life. So, I was just thinking about some of you. Let me say two sides of this. First of all, most of you in this congregation can look at verse 4 and say, I did this. I sought the Lord and he answered me. I don't know whether David is saying this of himself or if he's looking at a particular parishioner, but many of you can say, yeah, I've done this. Could I remind you of just one thing? Those of you who follow Calvary Bible Church faithfully in prayer, whether you're a part of the Wednesday night prayer time or not, if you're following Realm or not, or the prayer chain or whatever it is, if you're following this congregation carefully, please understand that there are still more than a handful of people in Calvary Bible Church who desperately need to experience verse 4. And don't forget that. As a matter of fact, with a congregation this size, more than likely you can bank on the fact that on any given day, we've got a lot of folks who've experienced verse 4 and a lot of folks who need to in the very moment. And on Wednesdays, we've talked about this over and over again. While you pray for their physical ailments and for healing, pray for their spiritual condition and demeanor because it is so discouraging and so heartrending at times. And verse 4 says, here's the reason why I praise the Lord always. This happens to me all the time. Thank the Lord it does. I hope you experience it. I hope you sense it. I hope you read verse 4 and say, I'm going to keep doing it. When you go to verse 5, I can't imagine a person who would not want this to be true. I can't tell very much, but we're used to this now. So those who look to him are radiant. Robert Alter, in his fine translation, he translates it, they are beaming. I don't know if I told you this before, but when Michelle decided on a couple of wedding photos to put up on a particular wall, I thought it was so interesting. She chose two. And with both, the expression on both our daughters is this. They're just beaming and radiant. This is a delightful verse. Those who look to him, meaning those who trust him, those who rely on him, they are radiant and their faces shall never be ashamed. In other words, they'll never get to the place where they say, I trusted him for nothing. And that's embarrassing. we'll never have to say this. The radiance, that's just the outward expression of how happy you are to know that you're in the hands of a good God in the midst of a badly broken world. And again, the psalmist, he's real about both the pain and the praise. Those who look to him are radiant. You folks get this, right? That he's not someone who's just putting on a good face. Don't you? You know that, right? He's not faking this. He's saying that even in the midst of pain, when I look to God, a smile is on my face because I know that I'm cared for deeply by him. And that's, I don't know what else there could be in a badly broken world. It is the way it is until he returns. But I love the joy in this. You saw the gladness in 2. You're following up in verse 5 with those who look to him are radiant. And then in verse 6, I guess this was the place where I don't know whether it's David or someone else. But again, he just says, look, I know people experience this type of thing. And then if you're wondering, does it have to be just a specific individual, a certain super saint? You go to verse 7 and you'll notice this can happen to everyone. The angel of the Lord encamps around those who fear him and delivers him. So let's stop for a moment and let's talk about whether or not we are truly God-fearers. Because you'll notice that you can't make the claim unless you're a God-fearer. It's one of the most important terms in all of the Old Testament, so it's good for us to spend a moment on this, correct? Because you'll notice verse 7 says, if you want this supernatural personal protection, if you want it, you have to be a certain type of parishioner. So I wanted to make sure that I covered this correctly. So I came up with my own definition, but you might recall the first one. So you'll remember that when you see the fear of the Lord in the Old Testament, it is emotion with devotion. Do you remember that? Emotion plus devotion. Why would I want emotion to be in there? Because we're talking about fear. There is no such thing as fear without emotion. So let's get the emotion in it, because I don't appreciate just the understanding of respecting God, because it's possible that you can respect him, but that could come short of such emotion like this. So you have emotion plus devotion. But my own rendering of this, glad submission to the ways of a God who is not safe. Glad submission to the ways of a God who is not safe. I was picking up on this last time. Emma, where is Emma here? Okay, so do you remember last weekend I asked you, did you see that clip in The Lion, Witch, and the Wardrobe? Do you remember it? That beaver says, of course Aslan is not safe. He's good, but of course he's not safe. And you know the reason why, right? Because Aslan is a lion. So did you hear the definition? And I defined it this way for myself so that fear would remain. Glad submission to the ways of a God who is not safe. Glad submission, of course. That's what the fear of the Lord equals in the Old Testament. It's always when you fear him, you obey him. Gladly, you say, of course, this is for my good. It's for his glory. Of course, I will submit to his ways. Why would I not submit to the ways of my Creator who has called all things good? Why would I want the opposite of that? That's the logic in church, right? The logic of Scripture. So you'll have the claim. And so all I want you to do, of course, as a worshiper, you take a look at verse 7. Would you like this supernatural, divine, personal protection in this badly broken world? Would you like it to the point where even death itself cannot keep you from God? Would you like that? You just make sure that you have this particular mindset. Not just a mindset, but a lifestyle. So listen to what, this gentleman scholar says about this. Protection and deliverance are not automatic. Because God expects evidence of allegiance in the form of fear of God instead of dread of life. Now, wait, now this gets interesting. So in the midst of all David faces in his kingdom, and all the threats on his life, in the midst of all the brokenness that you and I face in this badly broken world, Van Gemeren says, let's make sure that there's evidence of allegiance where we trade dread of life for the fear of God. Now, I like what other people have done with this in other places in Scripture. If you want to talk about being afraid of something in this world, who deserves to be the object of your fear? It's God. So let me ask you for a moment before we go any further, would you just, while you're in an act of corporate worship like this, could you again take stock of, just create a short list of your current dreads, your current fears? What are they? Now, let me add one that I've heard frequently recently. Listen to what I'm hearing that has to do with the uncertainty of the near future, a fear, uncertainty of the near future. Well, I've heard more than one older person say this. Tell me if you've not thought this. I'm not afraid for myself right now. I'm afraid for my grandchildren and my great-grandchildren and the type of world that they are going to have to trust the Lord in. How many of you have thought that? I'm hearing this regularly. I'm not personally afraid, but I fear for those next generations that are close to us, and what are they going to face, and how are they going to do this? And add that to your list. It's certainly one of mine. Put it in your list, whatever it is. I'm just saying to you, on the basis of Psalm 34, in this case, verse 7, make sure you trade that fear, those fears, trade them for the fear of God, where you have glad submission to the ways of God, who is not safe. This psalm is very clear about something that our world, including many churches, will reject. We talked about this Wednesday. If you look, for instance, at verse, I think it's verse 16, if I remember correctly, most of our world currently, and many, many churches going into the near future, will not allow verse 16 to be true. That's why I want you to know that he's not safe. You do not want to fool with him. I don't want to mess with him. Not with a God who's that powerful. Now, thank the Lord he's got other attributes that we sang about earlier, but I just want you to know that there is a condition in our verse 7. Now, let's get to verse 8, which is very, very, very important. And it's familiar to you. Verse 8, tucked into all these reasons for praising him always is this instruction: oh, taste and see that the Lord is good. So you're combining two of the senses. Do you see that? The first one is not one that you would normally use of your relationship with your God, right? How many of you use that sense? Do you use that in your describing your relationship with God? Taste that the Lord is good. You know why a poet, a songwriter especially, would use language like this. As Robert Alter puts it, concrete sensory knowledge. I'll get to that maybe in a moment, but you know why he uses language like this. If I tried my best to describe for you the taste of Turkey Hill All Natural Ice Cream, right? If I tried my best to describe the taste of it, and that's all you knew about it, or I gotta say this one. If I tried to describe for you the taste of Kirkland's Super Premium Vanilla Ice Cream. So how many of you have seen that at Costco? No one? Okay, this is great advertising. Okay, a few of us can pump this. If you try to describe that taste to someone and they've never tasted it, and all they know about it is what you said, what's the difference between the explanation and what happens when they get it on the spoon and in their mouth? And I'm talking a big spoon. What's the difference, class? I'm only saying this so that you wouldn't, you know, blow by verse 8. Why, oh, taste and see? Well, the ancient interpreter John Calvin, he runs quickly, as you would, if you've read a lot of him. Bill, you're seeing this in the writings that you're reading. He jumps on this very quickly and says the reason why we have to say this to a congregation is because all of our senses are dulled, he says. Our senses, our experience with the Lord is dull. I don't know whether he's right or if that's extreme language. I will tell you this. I'm glad that the psalmist reminded me about another sense with respect to my relationship with God, because nothing beats the taste of. And if you're trying to compare just plain knowledge through information versus a concrete experience with, Alan, do they compare? Not even close. Well, goodness, I would fail you if I didn't say, which is your experience this morning? You know about God in church like this? You're familiar with this because you've heard it? Or you've actually been worshiping along the way right up to this very minute because you know you've experienced a relationship with God that's changed you. And you're able to worship. You're able to praise in the midst of all the pain. You know that. There's a huge difference. I love that. Verse 8, oh, taste and see that the Lord is good. And then when you get to line B, blessed is the man who takes refuge in him. It's as if David says to us, do you need any incentive? You folks remember how the Psalms start, Psalm 1? How many of you remember how Psalm 1 starts? Do you remember that, Joe? The same term here, right? Now, by now, this is old hat for us. We say, this is the type of person that experiences this wonderful Hebrew term, happiness is plural. We don't know what to do with it except to say, there's no better life than this in a badly broken world than to have this relationship at the end of verse 8. Blessed is the man who takes refuge in him. It's the only way to experience all the goodness of God in the midst of the pain. While you're waiting for him to make it all right, here's this great condition. As I hope you see that. Verse 8 is something that you can do every single day. Every day. You know, if you really do love ice cream like me, if you really do, there's nothing better than having a few bites of that at every meal. Poor Michelle, she's going to die. I can't think of anything, if you love it, right? What's better than that? I know there's all kinds of problems with that, and Eric's going to ream me out later for this, but I know there's issues. I know. And poor Jen Klein would have a fit. I know, I understand that. But I can't think of anything better. So what if every time you meet with God, privately or corporately, what if you experienced another taste? What could be better than that? As a matter of fact, if someone said to me, I don't understand why I should even come to church, I would say, no, you need to come to church, all right? First of all, it's pretty clear in Scripture why you should come. But second, there's nothing like a congregation like this tasting him all at the same time. If this was communion, this would be a done deal, right, Ken? This would be a no-brainer. There's nothing better than a congregation like this experiencing him at the level of those senses. All at the same time. Nothing beats that class. Nothing. It's just a great section, and we could go on and on about this. It's incredible. If you're curious, you know verses 9 and 10, when you look at them, it's no wonder the Jewish folk, they actually include this into their Sabbath liturgy. This is very fitting in 9 and 10. Look at the privilege and the benefit of course it pays to have a relationship with God like this. And if you're reading, you know, and you see young lions and you see young lions in verse 10, that's probably imagery, especially in the Old Testament, of those who have a lot of money and a lot of power. But you'll notice their plight here compared to the lowly. And so it's just interesting. Now, finally, let's come to verse 11 and let's get into this. We can do this because we'll get to verse 20 eventually. Let's go to verse 11 for the sake of time. Go to verse 11. I said this several minutes ago. You may not remember, but I said, you know, when you get to verse 11, you'll think you left Psalms and entered Proverbs because of the way Proverbs starts and sounds very similar. An older person addressing younger people and says, let me teach you about this. So verse 11 is our final section here for those of us willing to learn. This is what's happening here in this worship time. Come, O children, listen to me. The teachability of children, and one of the reasons why I think teachers like to teach children is oftentimes they are sponges. They just eat it up. And especially, of course, in the Gospels, when Jesus encounters children, there's this wonderful sense of, I want to be near him and I want to hear him. And he's someone who's good to be around, and they know it and they believe it. And didn't he say somewhere, unless you have faith like that, you can't even get in? So there's something to this relationship. Come, O children, listen to me. And I would love for Calvary Bible Church, an above average congregation like this, I would love for us to take our rightful place as little children. Just be childlike. Every time we come to the teaching time and say, Lord, what do you have for us? I know some of you have been through the scriptures umpteen times. I know you've heard it all before. I know that, but here's this wonderful teachability again coming out in the Psalms. Come, O children, listen to me. I will teach you lesson number one. Do you see that? Lesson number one. Lesson number one. You folks familiar with Proverbs, does this look right? Does this look right that the fear of the Lord should be lesson number one? What's the beginning of knowledge in Proverbs? That's right. You know that, right? Sounds very familiar. These two writers evidently are onto something, that lesson number one for life. And to use, Bill Osborne, your term from the other night, Monday night, lesson number one for life and godliness, to pick up on the wording of a New Testament author, lesson number one is the fear of God. And do you remember the definition? Did any of you catch that? Glad submission to the will of God who is not safe. Glad submission to that. And verse 11, come, O children, listen to me. I will teach you the fear of the Lord. Why? Because you can't go any further in the Christian life. You can't go further in your pilgrimage unless you take the position of a child and say, teach me, Lord, teach me. Teaching people to do the things Jesus said to do assumes the teachability of a child. And so every parishioner that comes to Calvary Bible Church, regardless of their age, the teachability remains where we say together, we are on the way still. There's more to learn. There's more for us to grow into. More trust, more obedience. I'll teach you the fear of the Lord. Well, that's we can't go any further without that. And then verse 12, who doesn't want this? I looked carefully at verse 12. What man is there, or you'd want to read this, what woman? What man or woman is there who desires life, loves many days, that he may see good? Who doesn't want that when things are, quote, normal in life? Who doesn't want verse 12? Anybody want that? Well, you'll notice that some kind of morality is a part of this. You can't escape this. I said this on Wednesday night, I think, either last Wednesday or the Wednesday before. You realize that there's no poor readings of Paul or James or Peter if you would just get the Psalms. Faith and works, how does it work? Well, look at it in the Psalms. Don't worry about Paul. Don't worry about James. Don't worry about Peter yet. Get it from David first. If you want verse 12, you got to have verse 13 in your world. So do like I've done. Do like I've had to do. Number one, keep your tongue from evil and your lips from speaking deceit. Verse 13 is totally negative. Don't do that. So if you'd like to flip that in verse 13, what would be the instruction, class? Make it positive. Just be a truth teller. No matter what age or stage of life, be a truth teller. Second, verse 14. Turn away from evil and do good. You have both the negative and the positive this time. Turn away from evil and do good. That's I don't have to explain that, right? That's pretty clear. Three, if you want verse 12, you got to be like this. Seek peace and pursue it. All positive. Notice the poetry. Started with a negative, then went to both negative and positive, and then finished up with only the positive. Seek peace and three things. Now, before we go further, can I ask you, how much of your life does this encompass? How much? It seemed to me, Joe, it seemed like virtually all of my life is encompassed in this. My speech, my actions and my interpersonal relationships. Three of those three broad instructions. That's the kind of person who can experience good in this world, in this relationship with God. Which of course means you and I must be transformed by the gospel. So you ready for the Christian reading of Psalm 34? You ready? Let's do this. Let's look at the power of the gospel in Psalm 34. First, when you get to the cross, Psalm 34, I want you to begin at verse 17. When you get to, in order to get from Psalm 34 to you, before you can get to you, you have to get to your Savior. In order to get to him, one way is look at verse 17, and you'll notice that verse 17 and verse 18 and verse 19 and verse 20 did not happen to your Savior. By the way, if you're new to us, the reason why these minutes are critical is you cannot expect to embrace Psalm 34 in any way, shape, or form apart from faith first. That's why these minutes are critical. Verse 17, 18, 19, and especially verse 20. Do you folks remember verse 20 showing up somewhere else in your Bible? Anyone? Do you remember in John's gospel, while our Lord is being crucified, the prophecy of this psalm comes true. He keeps all his bones, not one of them is broken. The imagery in Psalm 34 is talking about the protective care that you receive from God. He guards your bones, the very depth of your being he guards, and yet our Lord, all he gets. Imagine this. The only thing he gets, they don't break his legs. But everything else, I want to say thank the Lord he did it. It's because of the Lord Jesus Christ dying on the cross for my unrighteousness that I have the privilege of becoming a worshiper that can actually enter into Psalm 34. And so when you read this psalm and you wonder, how can this be? Well, it can be because of the Lord Jesus Christ and what happened to him. But I want to show you something back in verse 8. Stay with me, right? This is the only time I get to see you today. So just hang in there for a bit. Look at verse 8. And I want you to catch the end of verse 8. Blessed is the man who takes refuge in him. And I want you to know that the Apostle Peter picks up on this psalm big time. I do want you to see it because it affects the way in which you and I leave this place. So would you go to 1 Peter? 1 Peter, you're going all the way to the right in your scriptures. If you go to 1 Peter, I hope you'll just, at least for a moment, experience some joy in this. Peter, writing this letter, he's got Psalm 34 in his brain. Look at chapter 2 and look at verse 3. And he describes your salvation experience in the terms of Psalm 34. Do you see that? 1 Peter 2, verse 3, if indeed you have tasted that the Lord is good, and that's describing your hunger for all this. It describes the reason why you come to church. It describes the reason why you thirst for the word and you love to sing his praises and you give to his work and you serve for him. It explains all of that, and it also explains why some of you don't. Did you hear that? It also explains why some of us don't. And then look at chapter 3. Look at verse 8, and I want you to read with me, at least follow along. This is 1 Peter 3, verse 8, and let me tell you how Psalm 34 affects your life. Finally, all of you, have unity of mind, sympathy, brotherly love, a tender heart, and a humble mind. Do not repay evil for evil or reviling for reviling, but on the contrary, bless. For to this you were called, that you may obtain a blessing. Peter is thinking still about Psalm 34:8, line B. And then he quotes, "For whoever desires to love life and see good days, let him keep his tongue from evil, his lips from speaking deceit. Let him turn away from evil and do good. Let him seek peace and pursue it." And he continues on and says, "For the eyes of the Lord are on the righteous, and his ears are open to their prayers. He looks at you with a smile, and he's bent down to hear your every prayer." The last line, "For any of us who have not taken the Lord Jesus Christ seriously up to this very moment, his angry face is glaring at us. The face of the Lord is against those who do evil." It's the opposite of the smile. His angry face glares at us. And he's Almighty God. And Peter says the reason why you don't have that kind of fear of him is because you've tasted him. It's a real experience to you. And if it's not, whether for the first time or the 101st time, please, before you go from this place, please talk to one of us about your relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ. Because you want to be absolutely certain that this kind of worship can be true of you today. It's a badly broken world. Thank the Lord we can celebrate the goodness of God in the midst of it all. And I'm delighted that we can do that together. I'm going to pray, and then these dear men will come and help you dismiss from this place. Pray with me, please. Father, make this Psalm 34 real to us so that we leave this place transformed by another revelation from you. I'm just so glad for these dear ones for the opportunity to respond to you together like this. And I'm glad to entrust all of us into your care. You know where we need you today. And I'm going to trust you to do what is only yours to do. Thank you for the help, for the morning, for the support. I pray that these dear ones will leave this place assured of your goodness and be ready to spread that word toward others. Father, please continue to sustain this congregation in the midst of these times. Continue to give this leadership wisdom as we try to navigate it all. And we're going to trust you to be able to withstand, but also to keep going, to endure and to progress and to thrive and to do it for your glory. I pray this all in Christ's name. Amen.